Tonight on NewsWatch, a strong earthquake hits Virginia. Tremors felt up and down the East Coast, including the nation's capital.
Plus, the battle for Libya rages on. A surge of gunfire and explosions erupt in Tripoli. Who are these rebels and what happens if they gain control?
And tracking Irene, the hurricane gains strength and barrels towards the U.S. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. A strong earthquake sends shockwaves up and down the East Coast, including right here in Virginia Beach at the Christian Broadcasting Network. Good evening. I'm Lee Webb.
And I'm Wendy Griffith. The 5.9 quake was centered just northwest of Richmond, Virginia. It was felt as far away as New York City. The quake shook buildings in nearby Washington, D.C., sending people spilling into the streets. Jennifer Wishon is there. Jennifer, tell us, what did it feel like up there?
Wendy, it felt like our D.C. newsroom here was like a ship on uneasy waters. The best way I can describe it is a rocking sensation. I can tell you, folks who live and work in Washington, D.C. are pretty shocked this evening. People started leaving the city almost immediately. Major thoroughfares like this one throughout the city are jam-packed. People trying to ride metro are finding getting home slow going. I spoke with several people who work in Washington but originally from California. They're used to earthquakes, but even some of those folks say this one was pretty scary.
The earthquake only lasted a few seconds, but it was long enough to rock the nation's capital.
The windows were shaking pretty strongly. So, you know, you could hear the noise like bang, bang, bang.
It came in sort of like two stages. There was the first wave and then sort of a secondary wave that came afterward.
So it felt like my chair was moving.
People immediately poured out of office buildings.
It was scary when it started shaking. I jumped under my desk immediately.
When it didn't stop and when kind of you could hear like the creaking of the walls and the windows, that's when we realized and everybody just dipped. The entire office.
The quake was felt in the White House, Capitol Building, and Pentagon. Parts of all three buildings were evacuated.
I'm from California, so kind of used to it.
But residents on the East Coast are not. Earthquakes here are usually much smaller.
Did you ever think you would experience an earthquake in Washington, D.C.?
Not particularly, no.
Now, many folks who work in Washington were, of course, at work nearly 10 years ago on September 11th when a plane slammed into the Pentagon. One woman I spoke with today says she felt the impact of that explosion. Today's earthquake reminded her of that sensation. And Wendy, she says that she's thankful today that it was just an earthquake.
Well, we certainly felt it here in Virginia Beach. My dad felt it in West Virginia. My boyfriend felt it in Raleigh, North Carolina. This certainly affected the whole East Coast. Any reports of damage there in D.C.?
Well, we do know that some stones fell off the tower at the National Cathedral. Some plaster fell at Union Station, gave some folks a scare there. However, we have not heard of any major structural damage here in the city. However, engineers are continuing to assess any damage. I'm sure they'll be at work late into this evening, if not into tomorrow. Wendy?
Well, glad it was more exciting than scary for all of us. Jennifer Wishon in Washington, thanks for that.
And on top of that, people along the Mid-Atlantic are preparing for the first big hurricane of the season. Right now, Irene is cutting a destructive path through the Caribbean. The storm is gaining strength in the warm tropical waters, and it's taking aim at the U.S. The predicted track of the storm is changing. We'll have the latest forecast from AccuWeather in a moment. But first, here's Andrea Garrett.
Across the Caribbean, trees and power lines are down, streets are flooded, and buildings are damaged. Hurricane Irene is packing a punch and headed toward the U.S. Irene is a Category 2 storm right now, but forecasters say that by the time it reaches Florida, it could be a Category 4, with winds between 131 and 155 miles per hour. Residents in the storm's projected path are preparing for the worst.
I remember Hurricane Andrew. I was completely unprepared for it, but this time I'm going to be prepared.
Generators, your flashlights, your lanterns, your charcoal, and then at the end we have water and gas cans for your generators and stuff like that.
Officials could start issuing hurricane watches for parts of the U.S. as early as Wednesday. After coming ashore in Florida, Irene is expected to take aim at the Carolinas and then work its way up the East Coast. Irene will be the first major hurricane to make landfall in the U.S. since 2008 when Ike hit Texas. Irene is now moving past the Dominican Republic and toward Haiti. The system's path looks like it will avoid a direct hit on the country, but even heavy rain from the storm could destroy many of Haiti's tent neighborhoods. Since the earthquake, residents are more focused on everyday basic survival than on hurricane preparation. They hope Irene overlooks their country.
Let the storm go somewhere else.
Forecasters warn that the storm can change direction at any time. Predictions made days in advance can be off by 100 miles. Andrea Garrett, CBN News.
For Hurricane Irene's latest projected path, we turn to AccuWeather senior meteorologist Bernie Reno.
Heavy showers and thunderstorms will continue to bombard Haiti, the Dominican Republic, and even though the storm is well west, Puerto Rico, as we go through Wednesday night and Thursday with the risk of flash flooding and certainly mudslides. Now, even though Irene's been interacting with the large and mountainous island of Hispaniola, it has still been able to maintain its hurricane status. So as it lifts off to the north and then northwest, by Wednesday and Thursday, we expect Irene to intensify rapidly, possibly reaching a Hurricane 4 status by the time we get into Thursday. And that means maximum sustained winds of at least 131 miles per hour. So this is going to be a damaging hurricane, especially for the middle and upper part of the Bahamas. Then Irene takes that turn off to the north, so most of its impact will stay east of the east coast of Florida, although we can see tropical storm force wind gusts and some very rough surf. Irene will take aim on southeastern North Carolina Saturday afternoon into Saturday night, specifically from Wilmington toward the Outer Banks of North Carolina, where we're going to be looking, unfortunately, at a damaging hurricane.
Thanks, Bernie. Well, turning now to Libya, where rebels stormed Muammar Gaddafi's compound. It appears his days as Libya's leader are coming to an end. Street battles broke out today in Tripoli between rebels and pro-Gaddafi troops. Thick clouds of black smoke filled the air. Gunfire and explosions rocked Libya's capital city. Rebels forced forces fighting their way into Gaddafi's fortified military compound. The big questions tonight, how much longer can Gaddafi hold on to power? What will a new Libya look like? And could it pose a threat to the U.S.? Dale Hurd has the story.
The sprawling complex, heavily damaged by NATO airstrikes, is the most defining symbol of Gaddafi's nearly 42-year rule. And its fall comes just one day after the rebels swept into the Libyan capital with stunning speed. Middle East analyst Waleed Faris says the capture of the capital by rebels will not stop the fighting.
The rebels now are moving to secure all of Tripoli. That is going to take some time, and the remnants of the old regimes, which will remain in some parts of Libya, will continue to fight the new government, which would be made out of the rebels. So the old government will become the new rebels, and the current rebels will become the new government.
It was not immediately clear whether Gaddafi or members of his immediate family were in the compound when it was breached by the rebels. Muammar Gaddafi has proven to be one of the world's most elusive wanted men. Here is Gaddafi in hiding with loyalists chanting "God, Muammar, Libya," in that order. The Pentagon had said Gaddafi was likely still in Libya, but few expected he would still be here. At his compound, stained by black smoke.
We smell the freedom now. We smell the freedom now.
Gaddafi's son, once the heir apparent, was thought to be captured, but last night he taunted the rebels with a triumphant appearance in the capital.
We are going to win because the people are with us. That's why we are going to win. Look at them. Look at them in the seas, everywhere.
But in fact, now it seems that the rebels are everywhere. And while the rebels are winning, a big challenge for the international community in the future will be to get the rebels to disarm.
The main question is going to be if these militias will disarm. And it's going to be very difficult to imagine that they would.
Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Senior international reporter Gary Lane joins us now. He visited Libya earlier this summer. Any idea where Gaddafi might be, and if he tries to leave, where would he go?
Well, that's a big question, isn't it? I don't think anyone really expected him to be in that compound when the rebels came and took control of the compound
today.
Yeah,
if he is, he's got a lot of courage. Right?
Well, he may be underground somewhere. There are rumors floating around. He's on his way to Venezuela. He may be in Tunisia. Even the South African government had to deny rumors that it was sending planes in the middle of the night to Tripoli to ferry him out of the country. But Gaddafi all along has said that he wants to remain in his country. He said it's the land of his forefathers. He wants to stay there. So he's probably hiding somewhere in the country.
Gary Lipp, since you were there earlier this summer, I wanted to get your impression. Obviously, this is a bad man. He's wreaked a lot of havoc in the form of terrorism around the world, including the U.S. But will Libya and will the overall Middle East be in better shape, North Africa, with him out of power?
Well, better, we'll have to wait and see, because there is a real chance that Islamists will take control of Libya. Maybe not initially. Initially, it may be secularists, people who believe in democracy. But if they don't have free and fair elections, or even if they do have fair elections, if they don't have a strong political party to take control, then Islamists can come in. That's a real danger and a real threat. But they're not out of the woods yet. There's still fighting going on in the south of the country.
Well, this, obviously, NATO played a big role in this.
Yes.
Should we look for NATO and the U.S. in particular to, say, get involved in what's going on in Syria?
Yeah. Well, this is very encouraging to people in Syria, because they're looking at what's happening elsewhere in the world, and they see that, hey, Gaddafi's out. I mean, they haven't found him yet, but he's really not in control of the country.
And I guess, why shouldn't we get involved in Syria? If we can bring down Gaddafi, why can't we bring on Assad?
Well, that's a good question, and maybe that will be next. But the big issue now is, if there are revenge killings, and if there are various militias and insurgencies that come about in the days ahead, will there be a bloody battle? And even a worse civil war than there is now. If that happens, if there's revenge killings and so forth, maybe NATO will get involved with ground troops. That's a possibility.
Interesting.
There might not be much stomach in the United States for that, but if we're seeing mass killings, that may happen.
War on three fronts.
We'll see what happens.
Iraq and Libya. Gary, as always, we appreciate your insight on this.
Sure.
Thank you.
The FCC has taken the fairness doctrine off the books. The outdated policy had not been enforced for more than two decades. Liberals tried to bring it back. It forced TV and radio stations to give equal time to all opposing viewpoints. Religious broadcasters objected to it because it could have forced them to air views contrary to their biblical beliefs. The head of the FCC says the fairness doctrine holds the potential to chill free speech and the free flow of ideas. Striking this from our books ensures there can be no mistake that what has long been a dead letter remains dead. We'll be right back.
I noticed a rather large bump underneath my left rib cage.
Chris Parrish was about to hear two words that would bring her to her knees and change her life forever.
When you say, I have pancreatic cancer, I'm sorry. That's what people think, is that you're going to die. And that's when the research started, and I pulled up Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and late-stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
I was in Chicago in 3 days. I knew it was meant to be as soon as I walked through the doors. The place renewed my faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
Never once did the doctors or the nurses mention you have 6 months to live. It was all about what we can do to make you feel better. I had my scan results. I had my blood work the next day. You're meeting with all these people in one place. Dr. Levin, he knew that I was ready to fight. He was ready to start right in on the inner arterials the first day. This is the biggest fight I've ever had, and I don't like losing.
Our teams of physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you innovative treatment options you may not even know exist. You'll also experience whole-person compassionate care here, unlike anything you've seen before.
You feel that security in knowing that they aren't going to give up on you. My milestone in the beginning of my treatments were putting my feet on the floor and having another day. The little milestones turn into bigger milestones. I just celebrated 2 years of being treated, but being alive. And that was huge.
Please call or go to cancercenter.com today. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
A weak economy, but no recession in the next year. That's the forecast from an Associated Press survey of leading economists. They expect unemployment to remain high and consumer spending to stay weak. One economist says she used to call that a half-speed recovery. Now she says it's just a quarter-speed recovery. Analysts are also concerned that Europe's debt crisis could hurt the global financial system.
Gold prices shot to another record high, above $1,900, before backing off today. A growing number of analysts worry that gold, though, is going up too high, too fast, and they expect a correction. But they also say the long-term trend for gold remains high. Gold is now one of the most popular investments in the financial markets. And because of its high value, gold is more popular among criminals.
Yeah, and as Lori Johnson reports, police across the country are issuing warnings about gold theft.
The price of gold is almost $1,900 an ounce and still rising. Unfortunately, criminals are finding ways to get in on the gold rush. This video shows burglars smashing in a glass case at a jewelry store.
They see the dollar sign, and I think they're going for it and willing to take a lot more of a chance than they used to.
But it's not just jewelry stores that are at risk. Police warn that criminals are targeting people wearing gold as well. In this security footage, a blind woman is attacked. She was wearing a gold chain worth about $100. The thief ripped it right off her neck. In Phoenix, police are looking for a man who's targeting high school girls. He engages them in a conversation before snatching their gold necklaces.
When you're wearing jewelry like that, you've got to really make sure you're not putting yourself in a position where the wrong guy is going to walk up and snatch your necklace.
It's over in a matter of seconds, but it's still terrifying for everyone.
Police say that women are generally the ones targeted. They suggest that if people are wearing gold jewelry, they tuck it under their clothing. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
Up next, who's behind the rape epidemic in Norway? A shocking look at a culture in crisis.
When it's warm, you'd love to open every door and let fresh air into your home. The trouble is, you'd end up letting lots of bugs into your home as well. Now there's Magic Mesh, the new type of screen door that opens easily and then magically closes itself behind you. So if your hands are full, or you have a forgetful family member, you can still let fresh air in and keep annoying bugs out. The secret isn't really magic, it's magnets, 18 magnets to be exact. When you separate them, they automatically snap back together, so bugs have little chance to enter. Magic Mesh is perfect for single doors, a must-have for homes with sliding doors, and is even great for campers and RVs. Because even when your hands are full, Magic Mesh will snap closed behind you. That makes it great for pets too, because instead of scratching and whining, they can come and go as they please. And it puts an end to slamming doors because it closes gently every time. Plus, it's so easy to install. No nails, no screws, no tools. Goes up in seconds and stays up all season long, no matter how often you, your kids, or your dog go through. So let the fresh air in and keep those annoying bugs out with Magic Mesh, a $40 value, yours for just $19.95. Best of all, Magic Mesh saves you money because when it's nice, leave those doors open. You won't have to use air conditioning. And when the weather turns chilly, just take it down and store it away for next year. But wait, call right now and we'll double the offer. Just pay separate processing and handling. Use one for your sliding door and one for your back door, one for your home and the other for your RV. That's right, you get two Magic Mesh curtains for just $19.95. That's less than $10 each. Don't delay. Call and order yours today.
To order Magic Mesh for $19.95 plus processing and handling, call 1-800-270-5583 or log on to buymagicmesh.com.
A U.S. judge has sentenced two Somali men to life in prison for hijacking a yacht and killing the four Americans on board. In February, Gene and Scott Adam were using their yacht to deliver Bibles around the world with friends Bob Riggle and Phyllis McKay. It was their lifelong dream to use their boat to spread the gospel. The missionaries were killed days after being taken hostage nearly 300 miles off the Somali coast. Norway is facing two shocking problems, a rape epidemic and the genital mutilation of young girls.
Horrible. Both of these can be traced to one source, the immigration of Muslims. Dale Hurd has the story from Oslo, Norway.
Weeks before the massacre in Norway, CBN News went to Oslo. We went to investigate reports that that nation's experiment with Muslim immigration and multiculturalism had gone terribly wrong, that Muslim radicalism was growing, along with violence and intimidation against non-Muslims. In the wake of the killings, some on Norway's left called a fear of Islamization a conspiracy theory. But the victims of Islam are real, and they are mostly Norway's women. They are problems Norway has never faced before.
Every woman in Norway does not have full human rights. There are women in this country who are denied their rights by their families, and they live in fear for their lives.
At the Red Cross office in Oslo, Monica Berge and Ann-Marthe Stifjeld take calls from Norwegian girls who face honor violence, forced marriage, and genital mutilation.
We have girls who call, and we really get this bad feeling in the stomach that something is seriously wrong. Most of the girls tell us that I wouldn't think about it, or I never thought it would happen because I live in Norway, I have my friends, I go to school, and I never thought it would happen.
They not only live in Norway, but they were born in Norway, and they speak Norwegian. But their rights are not protected, and they are controlled by their families. Hege Storhaug was a self-described naive left-wing journalist when an encounter with an immigrant woman changed her life and her career.
In 1992, as a journalist, I met a young Norwegian-born Pakistani woman, only 18 years old. And she had been married at gunpoint in Pakistan to a second cousin.
Storhaug now works full-time to protect immigrant women and girls from forced marriage, genital mutilation, and honor violence. Women, she says, who have been abandoned by the Norwegian government and deprived of their rights as citizens. Like four Norwegian sisters all sent to Gambia for genital mutilation.
They were aged 3 to 9 years old. They have been stripped from the possibility to become a full member of this society. And we have allowed it. We have allowed it.
Something else that Muslim immigration appears to have brought to Norway is what some here call a rape epidemic. Recent police statistics showed that in the capital of Oslo, 100% of assault rapes between strangers were committed by immigrant non-Western males, and 9 out of 10 of their victims were native Norwegian women. Kristen Spitznogel is a therapist who has counseled some of the rape victims, and she's been attacked in the Norwegian media for saying what many will not, that the rape problem is primarily Muslim men raping non-Muslim women, and any woman who does not dress modestly and wear the Muslim headscarf could be considered by some Muslim men as fair game.
For them, I think the hijab is a symbolic marker which separates the submissive, proper Muslim women from what they see as the Norwegian horse. This is what they told the journalists.
Spitznogel says Norway's left-wing establishment has been blaming the victims because the whole notion that Islamic culture is dangerous to women is very politically incorrect here. Hannah Herland is author of the best-selling book Alarm, Thoughts on a Culture in Crisis.
And not all values, some of them are excellent, but not all values from Islamic countries or cultures are excellent to bring into the European society. And I think many times the Norwegians fear to speak about that in fear of being called a racist.
But it's hard to call a Muslim immigrant a racist for speaking out against his fellow Muslims. Walid al-Kubaisi is a respected Norwegian writer and a Muslim who came from Iraq. He told us he's concerned about radical Islamic elements within the larger Muslim community in Norway.
We have a problem. Nobody, all deny, nobody say that. We have a big problem, but this will give a bad result in the future.
As in other European cities, parts of Oslo are now Muslim zones and may be subject to Sharia law or to the rules of local imams. When we interviewed Waleed in June, no one had any idea that a crazed gunman would start killing people because of Muslim immigration. But Al-Kubaisi made what now feels like a chilling prediction.
We don't know. I am not a prophet. But something will happen. Something will happen. I don't know. But I feel it.
Some on the left in Europe are trying to use the Oslo massacre to stifle criticism of Islam. But not talking about it won't make Norway's problems go away. Dale Hurd, CBN News, in Oslo, Norway.
Would you like beautiful, flawless-looking skin under your eyes? Now you can get the plastic surgeon's secret to erasing the appearance of dark circles, puffiness, and bags under your eyes. Introducing Lumitone, your secret weapon to erase years from your appearance that works on all skin tones and types.
My patients who use Lumitone see a decrease in the appearance of dark circles, puffiness, and bags underneath their eyes, and it works instantly.
So how much would you pay to never look tired again? $100? $200? $500? If you call in the next 3 minutes, you can try Lumitone at home for free. Just pay the low shipping and handling of $5.99.
I see a big difference immediately. It's definitely a little magic in the bottle that I was hoping for. I love it.
So, if you'd like to go from this to this, call or go to Lumitone.com within the next 3 minutes to try Lumitone for free. Supplies are extremely limited, so don't delay. Call now.
John Mapes is 42. Mortgage, married, two great kids. He wants to protect his family with a $500,000 term life insurance policy. What do you think it'll cost him? $100 a month? $60? $40? Actually, none of the above. John can get a $500,000 policy from a highly rated insurer for under $25 a month. His secret? SelectQuote. SelectQuote is impartial. They'll search the pick of insurers like these to give you a choice of your best prices. SelectQuote has great savings on term life for women, too. John's wife, Carrie, can get a $500,000 policy for under $16 a month. SelectQuote has helped make term life insurance affordable for hundreds of thousands of people since 1985. How about you? Just call this number or visit SelectQuote.com.
These days, some Texas residents are a little more willing to pay for city parking.
Yeah, that's because the city of San Antonio is using old parking meters to help the homeless instead of feeding the city's meters in order to park. Now citygoers can feed them to feed those in need. 25 retired parking meters have been converted into donation stations, and all the proceeds go to a nonprofit charity called Haven for Hope.
Because I know where the money's going, so I wouldn't be so skeptical about giving someone change. I could just throw it in one of these and know that's helping someone out.
$1.40 feeds somebody a meal. $18 takes care of a person for a day. So those little amounts of money add up big in somebody's life.
We all know that what are small donations, micro donations, really add up. And so if you can imagine these meters filling up every 3 or 4 days, it's a fair amount of money that can go to Haven for Hope right away.
City officials say it's a perfect fit with a tight economy. People are often more willing to give smaller amounts in change than write big checks.
That's a great idea, isn't it?
It is, but I guess you still have regular parking meters that you still have to feed because, it's no fun to get those parking tickets.
I'd rather put it there and than carry it around in my pocket.
You got that right.
Yeah.
Well, that's going to do it for us.
Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Good night.